this will be Grace Park 19. Grace Park 19. Are glad to see everybody out. You know, we were talking last week about, well, that the new has come. The new has come, and I tell you, it is, it's so easy to let them slip. I hope you understand what I'm telling you. So easy to let it slip. Because you are, you know, the scripture says, you're compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. And I want to tell you, you're also compassed about with so great a deal of circumstances and all kinds of things in your life. And it is, I'm going to say this, and we've been talking about grace. And I want you to understand, I think in the past 18 weeks, we've established grace is not the freedom to sin and do whatever. It's not that. J.W. had mentioned this, and it just sat so strong with me. You know, this is about walking in the light as He is the light. Christ is the light. And then Paul tells us to walk in the light. We in our lives, and I say we, I'm not excluding anybody, I'm putting myself right on the forefront, right here on the front burner, have to get by, have to get past making Jesus number one in our lives. Now what do you mean by that? He's got to become the only one. Not number one. The only one. Now just let that settle with you just a little. Jesus has to be the only one. Now what does that mean? Jesus got to be the only one. How much do we neglect Him? I just want to think about it. Do you understand that He has provided, He is eternal life that lives in you. Death hath no more dominion over Him, lives in you. The grace of God, the anointing of God lives in you. But how much do we turn our backs on that because we get busy with everything else? But oh Lord, don't we call on Him when we need Him. You know, I think, you know, I go back to those disciples on that ship. As long as it wasn't stormy, who needs Jesus? Yeah, who cares? As soon as the storms comes, what does everybody do? Get on Facebook, start a prayer chain. I'm just telling you the truth, guys. It ought not be that way. It ought not be that way with any of us. The grace of God lives in everyone that has accepted Jesus into their hearts. The fullness of God lives in you. These same things happen in the Old Testament. I'm going to give you some scriptures here in Haggai, and I want you to see the prophet Haggai and the prophet Zechariah, they prophesied about the same time. Just to tell you, in Haggai, in the second year of Darius the king in the sixth month, that was Haggai. The book of Zechariah in the eighth month of the second year of Darius. So we got one prophesied in the sixth month, one prophesied in the eighth month. But I'm going to show you Haggai first here. I'm in chapter 1, verse 7. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. What does he mean by consider your ways? Remember what I just told you. Who is number one in your life? Or who is the only one? Consider your ways. Sometimes we got to stop and go real slow and consider. Not just read the verse, but consider. Here's what he says. Go up to the mountain and bring wood and build the house. Let me back up a little bit. Now, listen to what he's telling the people of Israel. Go up to the mountain. What mountain do you think he's talking about? Maybe Mount Zion. Get some wood and build a house. Now let's back up to verse 4. Is it time for you, O ye dwell in your sealed houses, and this house lies waste? Now therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Now, that's not verse 7, that's verse 5. Now look at verse 6. You have sown much, and you bring in little. Ye eat, but ye have not enough. Ye drink, but you're not filled with drink. You clothe you, but there is none warm. And he that earneth wages to put into a bag with holes. Does this sound like pretty much everybody walking the face of the earth today? What is it? Everybody's trying to get ahead. You don't believe this, guys. Have y'all ever seen when the lottery gets $500 million and you try to go into a store and see everybody in there trying to buy a lottery ticket? Am I putting that down? I'm not putting any of that down. But why? Because we want to get ahead. But what does he say? The creator of the universe lives in you.
Yes.
Consider your ways. Consider him. You live in sealed houses. You're trying your best to get ahead. You're trying your best to make it through this life of drudgery. When the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, has took up residence in your very soul. Death and sin hath no more dominion over him. He lives in you. Why, guys, this is the grace of God. The grace of God. See, God, you know what? God didn't have to do any of that. God is a just God. Y'all do know that, right? You know what just God means? That means that justice is required. That means when sin entered in, there has to be justice. He's a just God. Justice was given in the cross of Jesus Christ. He didn't have to give grace. Grace is his love and his mercy that he provided. He didn't have to do that, guys. All he had to do by divine law was kill everybody. Wipe them out. Blow it all up. That's all he had to do. But you're still here. You're still here. Every one of you is still here. Why? Because of the grace of God. Consider your ways. Go up to the mountain, bring wood, and build the house, and I will take pleasure in it and be glorified, saith the Lord. Ye looked for much, and lo, it came to little. And when ye brought it home, I did blow upon it. Why, saith the Lord? Why is it you don't prosper? Why is it you can never have enough? Why is it? Why is it? Because of mine house that is waste. What do you mean, mine house that is waste? Whose house are we, guys? Is it all together? I'm just asking, is it all together? No. We got groups splintered out all over the place. So he's telling you guys, he's telling me, my house is lying waste. And you run every man to his own house. You take care of your own self first. You say, I mean, I just want you to think about this. Do you guys realize, and I'm just going to throw this out there, and I'm not trying to bring any condemnation, but you realize Patty and Oakley's not here today. Because Oakley's defibrillator went off, and Oakley's heart is really, really bad shape. I just want to tell you something. Every Sunday before service, I know Patty, probably Denise Withers back there in that room praying for this service. And when they miss, you do realize that's part of the body of Christ that's not here. But yet, in spirit, we can still gather as one, whether he's down in the hospital or whether he's here. You do realize that there's people out there all over gathered out and under all kinds of banners looking for one thing. They're trying to get something to drink because they're thirsty. They're trying to get something food because their soul is aching. They can't get warm. They can't get comfortable. They can't get anything. And he's saying everybody's concerned with their own self and their own life and their own this and all that. Well, my house goes to waste. And he says, you know what? As long as you got that priority, every time you try something, I'm just going to blow on it and it's going to come to nothing. Now listen, guys. You have to be careful right here because it can bring in condemnation real, real easy. And it should never be come to church because you feel bad. It should never be that. It should be the joy of the Lord. And I'm going to tell you, what does he say my kingdom is? It's not meat and drink. But what is it? Righteousness. Peace and joy in the Holy Ghost, the thing that everybody in this world is looking for. He said, it's in the kingdom. You want joy. You want righteousness. You want peace. It's found in only one place. What does he say? Seek ye first the kingdom of heaven and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you. Why does each man go and seek his own? My house is laid to waste, he says. Therefore, the heaven over you is stayed from dew, and the earth is stayed from her fruit. You know what he said? He is. Let me just say it this way, guys. The dew of heaven, that's the word of God. Let me just say it that way. The dew of heaven. You remember when Jacob come in to get the blessing? Jacob come in dressed up as Esau to get the blessing. You remember what the blessing was? The dew of heaven. You remember when the manna laid on the ground in Exodus and Numbers when they came out of Egypt? The manna didn't lay on the ground. The manna laid on the dew. Jesus said, I'm the true bread. So, you got Father and Son right there together. You can never separate them. That's what he says. Therefore, the heaven over you is stayed from dew. It's not given the dew. You remember the dew in Gideon? Gideon says, I'm going to put out the fleece. I'm going to pray to you and let the fleece be wet and all the ground dry. We put out the fleece all the time, don't we? But I'm going to tell you what he was really doing, and I've said this before, I'll say it again. That was the cross of Jesus Christ, because who is the Lamb of God? Jesus Christ, he came in what? The fullness of the dew, and all the ground was dry. Remember Jesus said, if they'd done this in a green tree, what were they doing to dry? He knew all the ground was dry. But Gideon said, I'm going to pray again. Well, you remember after he got up and he grabbed that lamb skin and he wrung it out, a bowl full of dew, right? We have this treasure in earthen vessels. But he says, I'm going to pray one more time and let the lamb skin be dry and all of the ground be wet. What happened? That's the cross. What did they do? They pierced her side, and out of his side flowed blood and water, and the lamb skin went completely dry. There's the death of Christ. And what happened? The river of life flowed. You see, he's putting out the fleece and he's giving the cross, Derek. You see that? There shall no sign be given except the sign of Jonah. There shall no sign be given except the sign of the cross. Therefore, the dew is stayed. What is the dew stayed? So we just got a good picture of the dew, didn't we? See, every time something in your life is giving you trouble, the grace of God is provided. The grace of God is Christ, but it's not just Christ, it's Christ crucified. Guys, the cross is not something that happened 2,000 years ago. It's ever present in your life today. You can bring it. I encourage you to bring it to the cross, not just once a week. This is a daily occurrence, guys. It's a daily occurrence. Now let's just go to Zechariah while we're right here in Zechariah. Well, wait a minute. Stay right there. Stay right there in Haggai. Let me go to chapter 2 real quick. Chapter 2, verse 2. Speak now to Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, the son of among you that saw this house in her first glory. How do you see it now? Guys, who is it among us who always says, man, I want to go back to the good old days? I used to sing this old song. Jeff probably knows it. I wish a buck was still silver. It was back when the country was strong. Had to get the low note right there. It's Merle Haggard. Back before Elvis. Always wanting to go back. He says, who among you now see that house in that form of glory? How do you see it now? How do people see it now? Torn down, busted up, looking no good, ain't it? Oh, this country's in terrible shape. You know, Ben Tracy was watching a show yesterday on the 60s. I don't remember a whole lot of it because I wasn't born until 67. I'm going to tell you what, guys, that's when TV first came on the scene. It's a wonder this nation didn't explode in the 60s. It was a mess. It was killing people. Riots all over the place. Civil rights movement going on. Vietnam War going on. I mean, it was a mess. Now we're up here and everybody's got cell phones and smartphones and two or three cars and TVs in every room. Got TVs in bathrooms and, you know, everything. And we say it's terrible. You know, to me, what terrible is, I mean, I just think about this, and I'll go watch them old Civil War movies, and it's like, okay, Tim got shot in the leg. Five guys get a hold of him, put a stick in his mouth, and get a saw, we're going to saw his leg off. That's terrible, you know. Now we go to the dentist, we want to be put to sleep to have our teeth cleaned. I'm just telling you the truth, guys. We don't want no pain. God help us. How do you see it now? Is it not in your eyes comparison as of nothing? Look at verse 9. The glory of this latter house shall be greater than the former, saith the Lord. And in this place will I give peace, saith the Lord. Where is it you're going to have peace? In the kingdom. Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. And in this place, although it looks like a complete, utter sham, and we want to go back to the good old days. So he's talking to people that have seen that old one. Man, I wish church was like it used to be. Now I want you to remember, Zerubbabel had laid the foundation. The persecution and attacks that they were going through, trying to build this house, trying to build these walls and all this stuff, the persecution and attack, they came in from within and without. It wasn't just the heathen nations around them didn't want it built. Their own Jews didn't want it built. Everything had come to a halt. That's why he says over here, guys, you go into your own little private world, my house lies to waste. Y'all ain't even working on my house. You ain't even working on my... Remember we used to sing this old bluegrass song, working on a building, working on a building. Remember that? Working on a building, guys, ain't you trying to get everybody saved? is Christ being revealed in you. And he will only be revealed in you as the heart turns to see him. But if your heart is occupied with everything else, you'll just be stuck over there in a corner waiting on some glad day. What he said, today is the day of salvation. There's no urgency. There's no urgency in the church world at all. What would you do if this is it? Jesus said, this is it, guys. He stood over Jerusalem and he cried unto them. And he says, I begged and you would not come. He talked about coming into the streets and singing. I piped and you wouldn't dance. I come unto you and you didn't respond. I'm here. He gave them 70 years to repent. He gave them 70 years to repent. 70 years. And they would not. Then what he says, he drew a line in the sand and says, all right, big guy, I'll not force anybody. Your house is left desolate. Live a life of hell if that's the way you want it. How shall we escape if we neglect so what? Great. Do you realize that salvation is not just, it's great. It's great. How shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? So here they are, temple's not being built, they've come to a halt, everybody's got their own agenda. Those raising objection to even building the house were the Jews. And these were the ones who hadn't gone into captivity. Not everybody went into captivity, but their whole temple and city was destroyed. A whole lot of them was carried off to Babylon, but a lot of them got to stay there and see the ruin. So here you got these guys looking at Solomon's temple in all of its glory, and then boom, it's completely, utterly destroyed. A lot of them get carried off slaves. But these other ones are right there, and they're looking at this destroyed temple, destroyed walls. You remember when we first started this lesson that we looked at what that was? That whole tabernacle, that whole temple, was the testimony of Jesus Christ. Well, it was destroyed. So there was no testimony. When there was no testimony, they had found another view of God. Another view. And history will show you, you can even look at the history, they had other alliances among them with each other. They had made contracts and covenants with the nations around them. So here comes the Jews back. Here comes Nehemiah and Ezra and Haggai and Zechariah trying to build this wall. You know what they're saying? They're saying, wait a minute, guys. We don't want this boat rocked. We got a good thing going here. I'm living in peace. We don't want this house of God to be stood back up. Do you see what I'm saying? There'll be everything in your life that says, I got a good thing going. I don't want to rock the boat. Because when Jesus comes into your life, he'll rock the boat. Because he don't play second fiddle. Moving him to number one ain't going to do it. He's going to move number two through 99 out the window. He's going to be the only one. That's it. He don't negotiate. He would tell Israel all along, when you come into these nations, do not go into them. Do not take any of their daughters for your wives. Do not have any part with them. But they failed, and we failed. We failed. Therein lies the grace of God. You do realize, guys, that repentance is not something you do once a year, once in a lifetime, once when you come up to this altar. Repentance is a lifestyle that you live every day and every moment of your life. When God really brings it around, and he just lays it out for you. You said, oh my God, why have you even allowed me to live? Foundations laid. The walls hadn't been set up. And I want to tell you something. Even after the temple was finished and Nehemiah came back,
He was one of the last. And you remember when Ezra came back, what did Ezra do? He gathered up all that was lost of the writings of Moses. The fragments of Moses, gathered them all up and presented Israel again with the full writings of Moses. Because they didn't have it. It was gone. You remember what happened when he stood up on that pulpit and read that? They all wept and shouted and cried, and my God, they just... He read all day long. The scripture says all day long. He started in the morning and went all day long. People think I'm long-winded. Wouldn't it be amazing to gather out all day long and just hear? What were they doing? They were gathering up the fragments. Gathering up the fragments. Remember what Jesus told the disciple. Gather up the fragments that none be lost. First the temple, then the walls. And that's the order. There's always order. First, it is Christ in you. Listen to this real careful. First, it is Christ in you. First, the temple of the living God. That's Christ living in you. Know ye not, you're the temple of the living God. That's Christ living in you. Then, upon that reality, the lively stones are gathered together. Built what? Built up into a spiritual house. The stones are gathered. The wall begins to come together and encircle the temple. That's New Jerusalem, guys. New Jerusalem, built upon of living stones. Do you see what I mean? First, the temple's got to be built, which is Christ in you. Then upon Christ being in you, I mean, I want you to really think about this, guys. Really, really understand this. Do you really believe with all your heart that Christ is in you? Or is it just words? Really? And let me tell you something, guys. You know how, do you know the only way that you will know that Christ is in you? Let me bring this down a little bit. If you got home, see, I'm thinking of three bears and porridge. If you got home and all your house was a wreck, you're going to think one of two things. Either somebody's broke in and robbed you, or my kids are there. See, I just want to see if y'all paying attention. Because y'all would say either one. I don't know. But you would look around at the evidence and say, somebody's been here. That's only evidence. But how do you know somebody is there until you see them? You may feel the evidence and all that, but I just beg and pray that you turn your hearts to see Him who is there. It's not some magic dust thing. He is really living in you. Your very soul was created for Him to abide in. New Jerusalem. And in the reality of Christ, that is nothing else. Nothing other than the body of Christ being gathered up on what? The foundation of Jesus. What is that foundation, guys? Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Flesh and blood, seeing me in this body, has not revealed this to you, but my Father has from heavens revealed this to you. And upon this rock, what rock? That thou art the Christ, the revelation of Christ up on that rock. It's the body being gathered up upon that foundation. A city set on a hill cannot be hid. So that's the setting here with Zerubbabel and with Haggai. I just gave you the setting. The setting here is somewhere between the foundation is being laid, but it all ain't come together yet. Y'all with me? So he's trying to encourage them to come together and to put God's house as being number one. That brings us to Zechariah 4 and 6. So you got the setting here. The foundation is laid, but nothing is finished. Then he answered and spake unto me, saying, this is the word of the Lord unto Zerubbabel, saying, not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. Here's the good thing about it, because if it was left up to you and me to build this house, she ain't ever going to be built. But by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. What is that? That begins with the indwelling spirit of Christ who lives in you. Verse 7. Who art thou, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel, thou shalt become a plain. And he shall bring forth the headstone thereof with shoutings, crying, grace, grace unto it. Remember we read that he would bring the headstone? We done this several lessons ago. The headstone goes on top of what? The walls. To do what? Look, guys, we used to build houses. You see my uncle right there. And we could set all the walls up. But you know, if we didn't have something to go on top, we had to take boards and go up to the walls to hold them together. I've seen houses where they didn't tie them in, and a windstorm comes and blows all the walls down. The thing that holds it all together is the headstone. And how's the headstone brought? Grace, grace, grace be unto it. Grace is upon the headstone. Who is the headstone? That's Jesus Christ. The grace of God begins with the headstone. The grace of God begins with Christ Himself. It begins for us with the revealing of that Son, of the indwelling Son. The grace of God begins to be made manifest to every believer. Now listen to this. Grace is not just something given to this one or given to that one. It's given to me and not given to you. You got more grace and I got less grace. Grace is given to the headstone. It's like the anointing oil. The anointing oil they brought into the high priest, right? And they anointed the high priest. Where did they put the anointing oil? On the head. Who is the head, guys? Jesus is the head. Now this thing rolled down the head and down the beard, went on the garments of the high priest. Let me ask you this. Who's the garments of the high priest? Is that you? No. He never said you're the coat of the Lord. He said put you upon Christ. So Christ is the head. He's the mitre on the head that set holiness unto the Lord. The anointing is poured over the head, comes down over the coat. He's the coat. He's the girdle. He's the whole nine yards. It goes down the coat and down upon the feet. Now them feet starts getting into me, don't it? Because why? We are the body. And what did Jesus do to the feet of his disciples? He come right in there and washed them. He said, you be clean every whit. Why? Because you're dead and your life is in with Christ and God. God is looking at the head. Who's his son holding us to the Lord? He's looking at the coat. He's looking at all the beautiful onyx stones and everything on the high priest. He says, hey, you just got one problem, man, your dirty feet. But I'll take care of that too. He said, you be clean ever whit. And you know what Peter said? Peter said, no, not my feet also, but my head and my hands also. There was no need for the head to be washed there. The head is clean. The head is clean. The head was expected, inspected, brought before Pilate. He says, I have no cause of this man. He's without sin. See, grace is provided in the headstone, and that headstone lives in you in fullness. Just like the anointing that I'm telling you about. The anointing, the Spirit of God anoints him. That anointing reveals him. The fragrance, the life, the changing power of his life begins to fill the body of Christ. You have that anointing in you. We've always waited on the anointing, haven't we? Let's gather up, huddle up, and wait on the anointing. The anointing is in you because the anointed Christ means anointed one. The anointing lives in you. Grace lives in you. And he's got a name, Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit is there to reveal him if we will turn our hearts and not be occupied with stupid stuff. Do you know, guys, I'm just going to be honest with you. There's been times when I've come to church knowing that I needed to mow my stinking grass. I've come in here and my mindset has been, as soon as I got to hurry, man. Maybe I'll get off. Do you know what I mean? When the King of Kings is right there on the side, ready to be revealed, but you want to go mow your stinking grass. Hurry up and get out of here so we can go eat. And the Lord is saying, come and dine, my God, on this water, you'll never thirst again. But you want to hurry and get to Bonanza. Well, he says, fine. There's plenty others. There's plenty others, guys. There's plenty others. Let me tell you something. Well, I was raised up in a thing who says, you know, it's predestinated. You got to be here. Let me tell you something. Every one of you, God don't need a one of you. He don't need a one of you. I'm just telling you, he don't. His salvation ain't dependent on you. He don't need you. You can go the way of hell today. Another will step up. This is urgent. This is something given to you. Something that he's poured out to you and said, if you will come to me, I'll give you life. I'll be your life. I will be your peace. I will be your joy. But if you won't, I'll just turn to this one. Another will come. He's offered it to the Jew first and then the Greek. To me, that starts putting some urgency in there. Thinking, my God. Almost like, hey, it's time to get going, you know. Time to get going. This anointing, guys, I want you to think about this. This anointing, and I can go give you the scriptures over there in Samuel and Chronicles. You know what David said about that anointing? He would never put his hand, he would never touch the anointed of God. Never raised his hand to the anointed of God. And even though it was type and shadow, you know who that anointed of God was? King Saul. King Saul was trying to kill him. Throwing javelins at him, made him live in a cave and do all this stuff. And David come up and he cut the bottom of his skirt off and held it up and says, I could have, but I have learned not to touch God's anointed. Now I want you to think about this. Everyone whom Christ lives in is the anointed of God because the anointing lives in him. When I start thinking about that, man, sometimes I want to put my hand over my mouth because of the stupid stuff that has come out concerning God's people. They could believe this, they could believe that, they could be in Never Never Land. It doesn't matter. They're God's people. I may have never put these hands on them, but I'll put these on them. Thank God for the grace of God. This anointing is made manifest by the revealing of the Son. The same with the grace of God. The headstone is anointed by grace. Grace, grace be unto it. Why? Why is it that way? So that the grace, remember the grace is the headstone that comes. Why? So that he becomes the measure of grace to every believer. What is that? That Christ may fill all and be in all. Christ all in all. He's the measure. This is why we've been talking about that to every one of us. He's given grace according to the measure of Jesus Christ. What measure is that? Fullness. God gave you a little bit of Jesus. God gave me a little bit of Jesus. That's hogwash. He gave you fullness. He gave me fullness. Can you imagine that? When I start thinking about this, how could this even be that he could give Derek the fullness of Jesus Christ? Ola gave the fullness of Jesus Christ and myself. I can't understand all of it, guys. All I know is the fullness of Jesus Christ lives in you. These are not things the natural mind can get a hold of. Thank God you have received the mind of Christ. Grace is made manifest in the revealing of truth. Remember how he comes? Full of grace and truth? All right, let's go back over to Romans again. Romans 5. 5 verse 20. I'll try to bring some things around. Moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. So I want you to get this. The law entered, why? So that the offense, which is what? Sin, may abound. Because where there's no law, there's no sin. We'll say consciousness of it. You could be driving down the road and you don't know how fast it is till the speed limit says 55. Before that, you're just driving along. You're wondering. I don't know. But here's the law entered so that sin may abound. Let's get that straight. But where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. Let me read the next verse. That as sin hath reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. Now listen to what he's saying here. That grace might reign and not sin. Grace reigns through righteousness, which is what? Christ. Let's establish something here. Where did sin abound? I want you to think about this. Where was all sin gathered up? All sin was gathered up, past, present, and future, in one place. In the body of Jesus Christ at the cross. Sin abounded right there, right? I mean, now he gathered it all up right there on that cross. Boom. But what does the Scripture say? Where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. He gathered us all up, and his death was unto sin. How does grace reign through righteousness? Now remember, when I say the cross, I'm talking about his death, his burial, his resurrection. How does grace reign? Through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And that resurrection is in you. The gift of God, the grace of God abounded, triumphed over death, over the grave, over destruction. Where does it abound? Where does grace abound? In you, the place grace lives. Where sin did abound, sin used to abound in you. Now grace abounds much more. Now this goes right back to that very death she was talking about right in the beginning. Let me give you a verse here. 1 Corinthians 12:13. Listen to this. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body. Whether we're Jews or Gentiles, whether we're bond or free, we've all been made to drink into one Spirit. Now, I'm still here in Romans. Know ye not that, I'm in verse 3 of chapter 6, that so many of us were baptized into Jesus Christ, were baptized into His death. Remember what we just read? By one Spirit are we all baptized into one body. And what is that one body? It's the body of His death. Therefore we are buried with Him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead. We went over these verses week after week, but guys, they're worth looking at again and again. Who's raised up? Christ raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father. Even so, we also should walk in newness of life. What does that mean? Even so. Even so means as one with Him. As He was raised up, as we are one with Him by that same measure, how dead was He? Completely. Right? Completely. As He was dead, so we raised up in that same measure. What measure? Life. Now remember, look at this. For if we've been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. Remember what Paul said in 2:20? I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. The knife I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God. Paul said it was a full measure of death, dead with Christ, dead to sin. Then he gives you that measure, not I, but Christ liveth in me. If we have been planted in the full measure of his death, now let me ask you, have we been planted in the full measure of his death or just part of it? Full measure of his death. Then we are to live in what? The full measure of his resurrection. Now let me tell you something here, guys. The whole Adamic creation was brought into that death. But look here in Romans 6:6. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him. Now we brought somebody else in, the old man. Who's the old man? That's food for thought, right? Who is this old man that he's talking about? Now let me make this, bring this around to you. I mean, we're talking about another man. Who is this old man? The old man is the Levitical and the judicial system of the old covenant. That's who he's talking about. Because who had the power? Who was the power behind the law of sin and death? It was the law. Right? The law was given to them, and that gave power to sin. The law did. It gave power to sin. Paul would say, you know, when I had never known lust until the law came in, and sin revived, and I died. I was fine until you told me not to do this, and the minute you told me not to do it, something rose up in me that said I wanted to do it. A whole religious system goes around and says, do this, don't do that. As soon as you tell a kid not to stick a fork in the light socket, what happens? Shocking experience is about to be had. Now, they were fine until you put a law down. Why? Because that's the Adamic nature. As soon as you say no, why? I'm going to do it anyway. You can't tell me what to do. And this goes on, and that's the Adamic nature. But where does it get its strength from? The old man. The old man is the law behind the whole thing. But what does Paul say right here? Knowing this, that our old man is... See, Paul could have just left it as we all did, but he says, I want to bring this old man into view. Because this old man is the one who's troubling each and every one of us. The old man, every Israelite. And how were they... They were married to this old man. How is that? They were married by circumcision in the flesh. Every male child that was born had to be circumcised. It was their sign that they were an Israelite. Everyone, 8 days of old, had to be circumcised. This old man, let me give you a word for today. Religion. This old man religion is who keeps the veil upon the face of his wife. Why? So that she cannot see the glory of another, even the new man. They put the veil up. When Moses came down from the mountain shining in the glory of God, what did they say? We don't want to look at you anymore. You're too glorious for us. Put a veil up. This is too much for us. Here's the deception of that. It's too much for us. We'll just wait for another day. We don't want to see this glory today. Put a veil up, Moses. Religion has put that same veil back up. But I want you to understand that Christ gathered this whole system up in his death. Paul is telling the Jews and the Gentiles that the death of Christ was the death of the entire system, including the old man. Let's just look at Romans here, chapter 7. I'll bring this thing around. Know ye not, brethren, for I speak to them that know the law, how that the law hath dominion over a man as long as he liveth. So as long as the man is alive, he's got dominion, right? How that the law hath dominion over a man as long as he liveth. For the woman, this is the Jews, which hath a husband is bound by the law to her husband so long as he liveth. But if her husband be dead, she's loose from the law of her husband. So the only way to be free here is a death. But let me tell you something. This, what Paul says, you know the law. So here you got a woman and a man. So the law says as long as the man is alive, the woman is bound to him. I don't care what. But if the man be dead, she's free to marry another. But see, grace goes a step farther here. Now remember, I told you what we're talking about, a Jewish system, a Jewish economy. Paul is saying, you know the law, and that's what he's talking about, because I just went over into Romans 7. We're still on the same line. You're buried with him. You're baptized into his death. Even our old man, we read that in verse 6 or 7, the old man is dead. Now Paul is breaking it down for him. Listen to this. Verse 3. So then, Paul says, understanding that, so then, if while her husband liveth, she be married to another man, what's she called? An adulteress. He's telling the Jews, everybody knows this. But here's what we do, guys, and this is just a side note. We bring this over into modern day church world, and anybody who's ever been divorced and remarried, we call them all adulterous. And Paul wasn't even talking about that. He's talking about this whole Jewish economy. We do our best to disqualify people when the grace of God is wanting to include. If she be married to another, she's called an adulteress. But if her husband be dead, she is free from that law. So that she is no adulteress. Thus she be married to another man. Wherefore, my brethren, now remember what I'm talking about here. Ye also are become dead to the law. How? By the body of Christ. He says this, guys. I did not only get rid of the man, I got rid of the woman. I got rid of both. This is a brand new creation in Christ Jesus. I didn't just take the old man out of the way. I took the Jew, the Gentile, the male, the female, the bond, everyone I took. You're baptized fully into his death so that you'll be free to marry another. Even to him who is raised from the dead, who is that? Jesus Christ, that we should bring fruit unto God. What is the fruit unto God? The fruit unto God is the increase of Jesus Christ. Paul was finding that these people were not seeing themselves as being dead with Christ to the old man. In their hearts, they were still married to it. They were still married to it. The sign of that marriage was circumcision in the flesh rather than the true circumcision of Christ. I'm gonna finish up right here. Colossians 2 and 11. In whom you also are circumcised with a circumcision made without hands, in the putting off of the body of sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. Buried with him in baptism. This is in Colossians. Wherein ye also are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God, who hath raised him up from the dead. Raised him up where? To live in you. You being dead in your sins and uncircumcision of your flesh, has he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all your trespasses. Not some of them. Not a few of them. All of them. Do you get the gravity of that, guys? I know for him to do that for me alone is a great mountain. That is not. He did it for the whole creation. That's where sin abounded, guys. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us. Blotting it out. which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, how? Nailing it to his cross. Having spoiled principalities and powers, may have shown them openly, triumphing over them. How did he do that? He was hung there buck naked, guys. You realize that? Beat to a pulp, stripped naked, hanging there. How did he make a show of them openly? He came forth in resurrection power. Why seek ye the living among the dead? He's not here, but is risen. Where's he risen at? In you. Mary looking for the body. Where's his body? Where's his body? People today is looking for the body that I may go anoint him. Hello, Mary. The anointing lives in you. You are part of that body. Wash clean every whit. Let no man there be a shadow of things to come, but the body is of Christ. So here we got this old man. Paul's talking about this old man. Let me go over here and tell you. Paul understood about this old man, and he says, when I went to do good, evil was present. I tried to do good, and I couldn't. Have you ever been in that place? Have you ever been in that place where you just wanted to do good, and everything you tried to do was a mess? You had a desire, but you just messed every cotton picking thing up you put your hands on. Every time you open your mouth to even speak, guys. Have you ever been like Andy Griffith and said, how can I get this whole foot in my mouth? I meant well. God knows I meant well. I'm trying to do good for God. I'm trying and trying. And this law just keeps coming up and damning me and cursing me and just bringing this mess upon me. Paul brings it around and says, and who shall deliver me from this body of death? What body? He's talking about the death of the old man. Who is going to deliver me from this? I'm in a mess here. I'm in a quandary. I want to do good. I'm trying the best I can, God, but I just can't. But see, Paul knew the end of this matter. He wanted to bring it down home to you and see this woman over here who's saying, I'm married to this man. I've got to do this. I'm trying to be delivered from this, but the law says this, and the law says that, and our whole time. Who shall deliver me? Oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord, so that with the mind I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh the law of sin. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. Are you in Christ Jesus? Absolutely. You're in Christ Jesus, and Christ Jesus is in you. There's therefore now no condemnation. Who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit? For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free. He who the Son has made free is free indeed. How? Because you're baptized into his death completely, raised up in his life completely. Made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, guys, get this, in that it was weak through the flesh. Do you understand that? Weak. Weak. You know what weak is? It was weak through the flesh. This, remember how he told Zerubbabel, not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord. You and your flesh and your mind ain't going to build this house. You can try all you want. Even you try to do the best that you can, but it's weak through the flesh. I'm glad that he'll show you that weakness, one. He'll show you that weakness, and you'll get down on your face, and you'll be calling out, grace, grace, God, grace. Oh, God, give me your grace. Give me your grace. And what does he do? He reveals his Son in you. He brings you to that place where you see this mess that you are, that you start hollering out, oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this mess that I am? And then Paul says, I thank my God through our Lord Jesus Christ. There's therefore now no condemnation. For what the law could not do, than that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son. Now see here, guys, this is the grace of God, because he didn't have to do this. He did not have to do this. God sent his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin. Sin is not sins, plural. Sin is you and me. sin, everything that what comes short of the glory of God. Guess what? In our flesh, we all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. For sin, that's for me and that's for you. For sin, He did this for you and me. God sent His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. My God, dear, I don't know if you get the gravity of what I'm telling you right here, guys, but thank God for His grace.
Amen.
Thank God for His mercy.
Yes.
Thank God for that anointing that lives in us. A cross that is always ever present that we can come to daily. A veil that is not up. The veil is done away in Christ. Do you realize that? Anytime there's a veil up, you can go right back to what I'm saying. You're not seeing the death of the old man. You're still thinking that you're alive and there's a veil up right there. But what does He say? He completely condemned sin in the flesh, completely put it away, completely dead to it. You're baptized into that death that you might walk in a brand new, uncondemned, unable to condemn you. There is not, therefore now, no condemnation. All we try to do, guys, is we try to bring this old junk. You know, it's just like this right here. I heard somebody say this. It's just like you got a man and a wife here. They've been married for 1,500 years. That was the Jews, right? A lot of pictures on the wall, right? A lot of pictures. So then the husband's dead. So the wife, the widow, she gets her another man. She tries to bring that man into her home with all the pictures of her and her former husband up on the wall. Won't work, will it? Won't work. Everything's got to go. You know? All the old love letters, everything's got to go. It just don't work. It just doesn't work. This is a brand new creation in Christ Jesus. God, stop working.